Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadra, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Marco Nunez with Essential Staff Care. Marco leverages a background in national politics and a spectrum of communications disciplines to provide sharp, insightful analyses for ESC. He also supports market and internal communication efforts for the sales team and partner team. Essential Staff Care is the largest provider of ACA compliant health plans and supplemental employee benefits to the staffing industry, serving over 2,400 staffing companies, clients, and enrolling over 750,000 temporary employees annually. ESC offers an ACA compliant MEC plans, fully insured major medical plans, supplemental fixed indemnity plans, comprehensive enrollment, and ACA audit technology solutions. ESC is an American Staffing Association corporate member, a corporate partner, and an award-winning member of the National Association of Health Underwriters. Over the past decade, the Affordable Care Act has transformed hourly worker benefits from an afterthought to a complicated but necessary reality. As if that were not enough, the coronavirus has further upheavaled the financial worries and increased worker demand for access to valuable, useful benefits. Since the inception of the ACA, Essential Staff Care has worked tirelessly to educate staffing companies on the emerging benefits trends and will have the biggest impact on their bottom line. In today's Industry Insider webinar, Marco's going to discuss the 5 most important benefit trends for staffing in 2021. Financial and benefit realities for hourly workers, virtual forward voluntary benefits, mobile integrated benefits enrollment, benefits and tax fraud schemes, compliance, and more compliance. So by the end of the session, you will have information on these 5 benefit realities that can impact your bottom line. So with that, I will turn the floor over to Marco.
Thank you so much, Amanda. And of course, thanks to TRICOM for having us. We obviously greatly enjoy and value our partnership with TRICOM, and we're glad to be here today. As Amanda said, we're going to talk today about some of the different benefit realities. Obviously, we're going to end up talking a good bit about COVID because that's what's driving a lot of these changes. We're also going to be talking about the ACA a good bit because those and some of the expected changes that will come in the future are also kind of driving some of this as well. So we'll just kind of dive right in, and we'll try and honor everybody's time and keep it as streamlined as possible. And then at the end, if we have any questions, we can certainly get to those. And I've got a couple of additional things that we don't have in here that I want to mention at the end as well, if we have time. So jumping right into it, the first thing we see that we want to look at when we're looking at benefit trends that are going to impact your bottom line is the financial and benefit realities of the average staffing worker. The staffing industry really has been in some ways ground zero for some of the unintended consequences of the Affordable Care Act. And maybe here's a good point for me to add in a disclaimer that I usually like to throw in there when I'm talking about the Affordable Care Act. We're going to talk today about the on-the-ground realities that we see, especially when it comes to the kind of plan selection that a staffing temporary worker has access to. There are no political judgments or value judgments in what I'm going to talk about today. I really just want to talk about the on-the-ground impact of these things. What we're going to see is there's been this unintended consequence of the Affordable Care Act on these bronze level plans. Now, the bronze level plans are important because that is the lowest level of plan that meets that new minimum that the ACA established for what has to go into a major medical plan, which is now called an ACA compliant plan. That bronze level plan, because it's the lowest entry point into an ACA compliant plan, is also not surprisingly the plan that is ubiquitous throughout the staffing industry. So any staffing firm that is an applicable large employer that has to offer an ACA compliant plan, with probably zero exceptions, is offering a bronze type plan of some sort. And these bronze plans have again taken the brunt of the unintended consequences of the ACA. And you see there on your screen some of the evidence of that. If we skip to the second bullet, we see that for 2021, the average deductible for a bronze plan on the ACA exchange is just under $7,000. There's an out-of-pocket max probably at around $8,000, $8,500 or so for the plan. And most of these bronze plans that you see on the exchange, and certainly the ones you see being offered throughout the staffing industry, have this high deductible, but they also have probably little to no copay benefits. And the copay benefits are the things that allow you to go to the doctor for $30 a visit, $50 a visit, you know, go see a specialist for $75 or whatever it is. So what that means is that with these, the typical bronze level plan that a staffing worker has access to, they're looking at a plan that has probably anywhere from a, you know, $5,500 to a $6,900 deductible. And the plan structured in a way where they are going to have to pay 100% out of their pocket until that deductible is satisfied. Now, in some cases, there may be some copay benefits, like they'll be able to go to a doctor's office visit for $50 each visit, and there will be no deductible necessary on that. But for these bronze level plans, that's really a rarity nowadays. And the reason is because the ACA not only established this new floor of required level of benefits for an ACA compliant plan, but it also placed other limitations on, you know, the cost and the cost sharing, the size of the deductible and all those things. But by requiring this higher level of benefits, and then only allowing a couple of places for that pricing pressure to go, it's created the scenario where the deductibles and out-of-pocket maxes have ballooned. And it's just not a very valuable plan for the average worker, because if you pop back up to that first bullet point there, you see one of a million different kind of stats we could find across the board that all say the same basic thing. And that is that the average worker in this country does not have access to a whole lot of cash. They don't have a lot of savings. Maybe they have, you know, $500 or less, and a $1,000 emergency is certainly not something that they're able to handle without having to resort to some kind of credit card issue or something like that. So when you combine these two things together, you see that you've got now the kind of average hourly worker is in a situation where they don't have a lot of emergency income to lean on if there's any kind of medical emergency. But the plan selection they're being offered, even through the ACA exchange, for this lowest, most accessible level bronze plan, is something that they're going to have to come out of pocket for the first several thousand dollars of their bills. So, you know, even if they're getting a subsidized plan on the exchange and they're paying $50 a month, let's say, for their bronze plan, they're paying $50 a month for the privilege of paying the next $5,000, $6,000, $7,000 of their medical bills for that year out of their own pocket. Not a scenario where there's a ton of value. You add to that then, you know, looking at 2020 MetLife's U.S. Employee Benefit Trends Survey, showing that 80% of respondents now believe that employers are responsible for employee health. This is one of the impacts we've seen of the pandemic, is that workers have become way more aware of the importance of some kind of benefit plan to help, you know, cover the costs when they have medical emergencies. So the impact of this, as we just talked about, is that workers are far more aware than ever of their need for this. And therefore, employers that provide these benefits are going to be rewarded with the ability to recruit the top talent in the marketplace, and also the ability to retain the top talent in the marketplace. The next thing we look at that is a big trend for this year is that telemedicine realities. And again, this is another one that really has been exacerbated by COVID. We already in the years leading up to, you know, the 2020 pandemic shutdowns, We're seeing a huge rise in the usage and addition of telemedicine to benefit plans being offered to employees. You know, starting way back in, you know, probably, you know, 2017, 2018, we were already starting to see a huge uptick in momentum towards virtual telemedicine services. So, you know, looking at the stats again there on the screen, according to an early 2020 doctor.com report, uses of telemedicine in 2020 was already up 33% from the previous year. And that was early in 2020 before the shutdowns really, really got rolling. July 2020, medicaleconomics.com article reports that 83% of patients expect to use telemedicine after the pandemic resolves. Folks are being forced to use these virtual telemedicine services because either they don't want to go into a doctor's office and be exposed to COVID potentially, or that's just the best solution that's available to them at that moment. And once they use the service, they're finding that they actually enjoy it and that that's actually a very efficient way for them to treat things like a common cold or flu or something like that. And so we're going to see more and more of them using it. And then finally, you got another stat that backs that up, showing that at Stanford's Medical Center, a huge percentage of their visits were already these telemedicine realities. So the impact, as we see, is that virtual forward voluntary benefits are now really an expectation, not a luxury. This idea of telemedicine has really kind of permeated, you know, the collective mind, if you will. And, you know, folks are very aware from the employee level to the employer client level of the value and benefit of having telemedicine in there. It's kind of the thing right now that everybody expects to be part of their benefits. But there is going to be a shift, and we're actually proud to be really kind of helping spearhead that shift. And that is that these legacy telemedicine services, like a Teladoc, let's say, over time are actually going to be overtaken very quickly here in the next couple of years by telemedicine services that are actually designed to provide more of a virtual primary care solution. And that's actually something that that ESC is going to be announcing here very soon, is a new product offering that we're going to have that that integrates in this virtual forward telemedicine, teleprimary care model. So it's not just you pick up the phone and you get some random moonlighting doctor who's giving a couple hours to the telemedicine service, never talked to you before, never talked to you again, doesn't know anything about your history. These newer services that are coming online are integrating in a primary care approach to that, so that they are actually able to connect you with the same doctor virtually each time. You're able to have more of a physical world experience. They're able to keep track of your medical records, of your tests, and all that stuff's able to happen in a much more streamlined virtual way. So another thing to definitely be keeping an eye out for as we announce that in the future. Third one to look at for this year is benefit enrollment realities. You know, again, one of the major shifts that COVID has really implemented that we've all seen, obviously, is this work from home phenomenon. But it's also in the staffing world driven this more remote onboarding phenomenon as well. And a lot of staffing firms have really been increasing their investment in the technologies and moving things over to that. And so we see a lot more of this virtual recruiting, virtual onboarding scenario. And one thing that's really important to be aware of, and as best you can have tied into that, is a benefit enrollment feature that allows you, as you're doing this virtual or remote onboarding process, you're also able to offer benefits in seamlessly through that process as well. Bullhorn's 2021 Global Recruitment Insights and Data Survey, 28% of respondents were more likely to adopt a digital transformation strategy, 35% have already ramped up, 33% more remote recruiting will come. You know, again, we're seeing a lot of staffing firms moving to this more remote-based thing, and as a result, they're going to need to make sure that they've got this integrated benefit enrollment feature to the benefits that they're offering for folks. Because without that, obviously, then they're going to have this disjointed process where an individual goes on remotely, fills out their onboarding information, but because there's not a benefit enrollment part of it, what would then have to happen is they'll be sent some kind of follow-up email or call, or even maybe a letter happens sometimes with other benefit providers out there that gives them a 1-800 number to call up. And what we have found is that whenever you do enrollment that way, you literally get a sixth or less of the amount of enrollment than if you do it the way that we do it as best practice, which is making sure that there is a 100% offer at the time of onboarding, so that when they're already filling out that other paperwork, it's no big deal for them just to fill out a benefit election form or declination form as well. Now, here's the other really important part that that process bleeds in. We're going to get into the importance of compliance here at the end. But when you have a best practice for your staffing firm that has an integrated electronic enrollment process that is part of onboarding, you are able then to ensure that you've got 100% coverage on your offer of benefits to folks. And on the back end, then you're able to then refer to or pull that information, provide it to the IRS, DOL, whoever you need to, should you be in a position where you need to prove that the offer was made for an ACA compliant plan or whatever those things are. So again, we've seen this shift slowly over the last several years, where staffing firms have slowly been digitizing everything they're doing, from back office to front office to, you know, onboarding and all those different things. COVID again has really kind of put that dynamic on steroids, and we're really seeing that as a big, huge trend for this year. Again, we've invested an enormous amount of time and resources, and we will continue to, in making sure that we have seamless electronic enrollment options for our clients. So definitely want to make sure that you're integrating those in if you don't already have them for your benefit offering process. Okay, one other reality that's really important to be aware of this year is benefit and tax fraud schemes. Unfortunately, what we've seen from the very beginning of the ACA, and I guess maybe before I start there, let me back up. One of the things that was really interesting to observe about the implementation of the ACA from the seat that we have was watching the staffing industry, who prior to that point didn't have an enormous breadth of experience with benefits, right? Because the reality was that prior to the ACA, it's hard now to get a major medical ACA compliant plan to offer to a temporary worker in a 400% turnover environment like staffing. Prior to the ACA, it was next to impossible. So voluntary benefits and things like that were certainly something that staffing firms were used to, but getting into, you know, the depths of group sponsored ERISA plans and all these different things were certainly something that a lot of staffing firms didn't have an enormous amount of experience with. As a result, what we saw was when the ACA first came on board with all the complexities it had, we watched a number of bad faith actors emerge who clearly saw an opportunity to take advantage of the confusion and the complexity of the new laws and push schemes and scenarios to staffing firms that, unbeknownst to them, were incredibly risky or downright illegal in some cases. You add to that a dynamic we've experienced over the last year or two, where we've actually seen a couple of different entities targeting the staffing firm with some tax fraud schemes. These double dip tax fraud schemes where you set up a benefit plan, the employee takes out an enormous premium payment for the plan, which is like, let's say $1,000 a month. But then it's returned to them on the back end as a benefit for a monthly wellness benefit. And as a result, the overall tax liability of the employer is supposed to be lowered. And the employee actually, because it's pre-tax money and then it gets returned to them in a benefit form, actually gets more money than they would have otherwise. It's anything that sounds too good to be true, it probably is. But both of these areas, both on the benefit side and the tax fraud double dip side, are something we really feel like we need to make folks aware of and make sure that they're being very aware of. We are very much planning at Essential Staff Care over the coming months to really ramp up our webinar and kind of podcasting approach things, because there are more than likely going to be additional changes made to the ACA in the coming months. And what we've seen in the past is that every time these changes are made, the charlatans come out of the woodwork and try and make a buck off the confusion it creates. So please, you know, expect more communication from us in the future every time there's a change to the ACA or anything. Impact of this, you know, obviously the ACA, ERISA, or state penalties, you know, for failure to properly comply with payroll taxes or whatever the things are, existentially high. You don't ever want to be caught in a situation where you're having to deal with or explain your way out of one of those, because the fines can get enormously high very quickly. On the tax fraud double dip side, we just want to always throw out there, you know, insurance is a highly, highly regulated industry, both at the state level and at the federal level. So there's not a lot of special, unique, we've figured out this trick that nobody's figured out when it comes to insurance, right? The real difference is in the way that you construct the benefits and then the administration and the way that you service clients and those things, which are obviously all the things that we focus on. So if it sounds too good to be true, it probably is, especially when it comes to any kind of benefit or, you know, tax fraud scheme. So please just be really aware of that stuff. I know the American Staffing Association has put out some alerts and warnings on different things. So, you know, if you ever are proposed something by someone and it sounds a little weird, sounds a little too good to be true, definitely do the due diligence, whether it's reaching out to ASA, whether it's reaching out to us, or an ERISA attorney, you know, find someone that can give you a little guidance and give you a little feedback on whether or not that's actually a safe thing for you to pursue as a firm. Okay, compliance. This is going to be one of the big ones for this year and for the years to come, obviously. You know, we've got a number of things that we see kind of reflected on the screen there that have happened over the last year or two. And really what it all kind of boils down to is we've had an enormous amount of small businesses close. And we've had for at least a chunk of time an enormous amount of people not earning paychecks and therefore not having payroll taxes and social security taxes and things taken out and sent back to the government. So government receipts are obviously down a lot. And you know, the IRS has made it very clear that they were going to continue increasing stringency on ACA reporting and compliance enforcement. They have, since the beginning of the implementation of the employer mandate, beginning of 2015, and the reporting requirements that came with that, the IRS each year has extended what's known as the good faith transition relief, which is basically that as long as you, we're gonna assume that everybody that submits something tried their best, even if it's totally wrong and it needs to be completely revised, we're not gonna ding you for it. We're gonna trust that you gave your best effort and then we're gonna give you a chance to revise it. They, at the beginning of this year, extended it and also clarified that this would be the last time they would be extending it. So yet another indicator that the IRS is going to get more and more serious about ACA compliance and reporting enforcement. After this year, the good faith reporting transition is going to go away. And that means that an even stricter set of standards are going to be applied to reporting. So compliance is definitely one of those things that is absolutely going to affect your bottom line if you're not careful and watching and making sure that you're dotting all of your I's and crossing all of your T's. We also see that six states, California, District of Columbia, Massachusetts, New Jersey, Rhode Island, and Vermont currently have individual mandates requiring ACA compliant coverage. That is another layer, depending on whether or not your staffing firm operates in those states, of compliance that you're going to need to be aware of, because for some of those states, there is an employer reporting requirement that for individuals living in those states, you have to report proof that you offered them coverage. Now, the great thing is that a lot of these states are just mirroring the federal reporting standards. So they're trying to make it as easy as possible and saying, look, you can just send us the report that you already developed for your federal, IRS ACA compliance stuff. But that is something that you definitely need to be aware of on the staffing firm side and make sure that you're doing all the reporting and things you need to on the state level for those six states that have that. All right, so impact on the compliance side is that the IRS has announced no extensions to the good faith relief transition. There's going to be less leniency across the board from all the government bodies, from the IRS, from DOL, Department of Labor, any kind of ERISA related organizations. They're all, especially with the focus on shoring up the Affordable Care Act from the Democratic led Congress and White House, they're really going to be pushing for much stricter compliance on those different things. And again, as we talked about before with the benefit offering and enrollment aspect of things, the only 100% safe process is a 100% accept or decline offer best practice for your staffing firm. The only way to be totally sure that you're not missing anything and that you're getting everything covered is to make sure that you're offering benefits to every person that comes through your door, and fills out that onboarding paperwork. And if you are an applicable large employer under the ACA, then offering that MEC plan, that MEC plan to everyone, that gives you that coverage on that A penalty. But again, you're going to have to be able to go back on the back end and prove to the IRS that you did make that offer of coverage to everyone that came through that door. So the only 100% way to be safe is to make sure that you've got that 100% accept or decline. You're capturing the accept or decline digitally, you're storing it, and able to then refer back to it a little bit later. So I wanted to kind of keep this as streamlined as possible. I know we've got a couple of minutes left for questions, and if we don't have any questions, and I'll stop talking in just a second here, Amanda, to see if we do. If we don't, I do have a couple of things that I want to talk about that are kind of updated from the recent weeks with the American Relief Plan Act, ARPA. So do we have any specific questions, Amanda?
We do not have any questions at the moment. So go ahead and submit any questions you have in the chat or the Q&A feature. And while, we're waiting for that, if you want to go ahead and cover your next item.
Yeah, absolutely. And, and again, if you're watching this on replay or you're not able to get your, you weren't able to get your question in time, again, you can always feel free to reach out to us at Essential Staff Care. And we're more than happy to help you, work through any questions as best we can on that. So kind of wrapping things up, a couple of things we didn't have in the original slides, but have kind of shifted that you need to be aware of, because again, this really fits under this banner of a benefit reality that's going to impact your bottom line that you need to be aware of. So, recently passed ARPA, American Rescue Plan Relief Act. I think I added extra terms in there. Two things that they did that were benefits related. The first was that they dramatically increased ACA subsidies availability on the exchanges. This seems to really impact folks who are in the kind of 250% to 400 or 600% of the federal poverty level. Folks below that, 150% of the federal poverty level and below, certainly, which is around $20,000 a year for an individual, already had access to, basically a free bronze plan through the ACA exchange. The changes through ARPA and the increase in subsidies have now expanded that so that some folks actually have access to not just a bronze plan, but a free silver plan. And subsidies are expanded up through those higher income bracket ranges. So again, that 400 to 600% of the federal poverty level, where previously there really weren't a lot of subsidies available for them, there are a little bit more subsidies available for them now. And then the other thing that ARPA did as it goes to ACA exchange plans was that it set a threshold cap so that no person that goes to an exchange and enrolls in a plan will pay more than 8.5% of their own personal income in premium. Obviously, right now on the employer mandate side, the affordability threshold for this year currently is 9.83%, I think. So we're talking about a difference of roughly 1.5%. You know, there's nothing in the works that we know of right now that is going to change the employer mandate to lower that affordability threshold down to 8.5%, but we also kind of expect that to happen at some point in the future. We expect at some point that Congress will probably pass something that just makes it 8.5% across the board for employers as well as ACH change plans, but that's just something to kind of be aware of for now. What is definitely going to happen with this expansion of ACA subsidies is more individuals are going to go to the exchanges and get subsidized coverage. Now, that's important because with the ACA, obviously, it is the enrolling in a plan with subsidized coverage that triggers the B penalty for an employer. So what this all means on that side of things is, we actually just had a webinar a couple of weeks ago where we talked about this. Staffing firms are definitely going to want to take a look at whether or not it makes sense to adjust their ACA strategy. You know, depending on what their strategy currently is, some are offering affordable minimum value plans, ACA compliant plans, that keeps their employees from being able to go to the exchange and get a subsidy, but it does completely get that employer out of the AMB tax. What most companies are doing are offering the MEC plan to everybody that comes through. That gets them out of, as an employer, the A penalty, but it leaves them exposed to the B penalty if someone doesn't enroll in the MEC plan and they go to an ACA exchange and get subsidized coverage. What we've seen so far up until now is it's been a fairly small number of individuals that actually do go to the exchange, turn down the MEC plan and get subsidized coverage. But obviously where subsidies have been expanded, there's an expectation that more individuals are going to go to the exchanges. So again, staffing firms are going to want to take a look at their own particular complex situation and figure out whether or not it makes sense for them to adjust their strategy. In a lot of cases, it won't necessarily make sense, but in some, it definitely will. The other thing that ARPA did was that it passed this requirement that an employee that is eligible for COBRA insurance, and COBRA is the continuation of benefits, which allows an employee who is enrolled in major medical coverage. We actually do this with our essential staff care fixed indemnity plan as well. That's actually not something that's always done, but we actually extend the COBRA benefits to folks from that. But ARPA, the legislation basically mandated free COBRA coverage for anybody that is eligible, I think up through August. So there's a 6-month window that it is put in there. That is something you're going to need to be very aware of, because in some cases, if you're offering a self-funded plan as an employer, you may have some responsibility there and some things you're going to need to do as far as sending out notifications. On our end of things at Essential Staff Care, we're doing everything we can to create as turnkey, easy lift a solution for our clients as possible. On the fully insured plans, we are taking care of everything for them. And we are actually currently going through, they just within the last couple of days have announced some of the additional regulations and clarifications. So we're still working through the process on the self-funded plan side. The overall point though is just to make you aware of that. And if you are offering benefits and there is COBRA coverage, you do need to be checking into it, making sure that either your provider or you have yourself covered on the requirements for that. And again, you can go on our website, you can find a webinar that that John and I did recently talking specifically about the ACA subsidy and the ARPA subsidies for the COBRA continuation coverage. So those are the last couple of things that I wanted to go over. And so I don't think we had any other questions come in. Nope. So Amanda, I'm going to pass it back over to you. And again, folks, if you want some information specifically about the ARPA ACA subsidy expansion, you can go to essentialstaffcare.com/ARPA-resources. And we've got a landing page there with some information. Again, Amanda Trykov, thank you all so much for your time, and I'll pass it back over to you.
Wonderful. Thank you, Marco. I appreciate you covering this important topic for us today. If anyone has any specific questions, please feel free to reach out to me or ESC directly. If you have any ACA or insurance questions that they might be able to assist you with. So with that, I'd like to thank you all for joining us on today's session entitled The 5 Benefit Realities Guaranteed to Impact Your Bottom Line. Thank you again for your participation, and watch for information on our next webinar session. Have a great day, everyone.